It's a pleasure to introduce our first keynote speaker, Sridhar Iyer. He's a professor at IIT Bombay and teaches in the computer science department. He is very passionate about education, especially technology in education, and that's for very appropriate for Computational and Thinking School conference. He heads a program on educational technology at IIT Bombay. He's one of the leading publishers from India in the area of computer science education, and he's published widely in many international conferences. Among the various projects he leads is one called Telots, which is an attempt at learning of thinking skills. So not just in computer science, but in general, how do people learn thinking skills? That's what it is an attempt at. He had got into CS education in schools much before CS Pathshala in the form of Computer Masti, a collection of books that he has published for teaching computer science, computers from standards 1 to 8. And these can be downloaded from the site because it's available for free. His interest in education can also be seen from articles he's written for Jantar Mantar, which is a children's science education magazine. So you can read these articles also when he's not involved in computer science education. He enjoys himself by trekking, playing volleyball, and he has also played bridge. I think that he plays bridge is a good enough reason to invite him for a talk for any conference. And with this, I'll hand it over to Sridhar Iyer. Over to you, Sridhar.
Thank you very much, Venki, for that introduction. Thanks a lot to Venkatesh Raman and the other organizing committee for inviting me. So all of this, what Venki has said, is not there on my bio. It so happens that we know each other from earlier, and so he is actually put in a lot of additional stuff. Anyway, thank you very much for that introduction, Venki. And with that, let me get started. I'll just quickly share my screen. Okay, so this talk is about computational thinking, education, and research. And since most of you are aware of the CS Pathshala work, I'm not going to touch upon that work at all in this talk. I'm going to try to give you some different examples. To begin with, let me quickly give an introduction to this department, since many of you may not have heard of education technology as a department. So before EdTech became so popular and all that, you know, we started this program a decade ago. This is actually our decade of EdTech at IIT Bombay that we are celebrating. And currently we have 5 core faculty, several associated faculty from other departments, and postdocs, and 25 students are there, and about 12 PhDs have graduated. And we have also admitted our second MTech batch. So we have had one batch of MTech which is ongoing, and the second batch has joined us in virtual mode, and hopefully by January they'll be here physically. If you want to know more about, you know, what all we do, you can actually just Google Education Technology IIT Bombay. It will take you to our website, and there you can see all the research areas and, you know, different themes that we work on, what are the MOOCs that we have created. So we've done a lot of teacher training MOOCs. Maybe some of you have also participated in them in how to use education technologies in the classroom and how to do CS teaching in the classroom and so on. Okay, so with that, let me do a quick activity. What I would like you to do is get an idea of what is your idea of computational thinking. So if you could open a new tab on your browser and go to menti.com and type in this code, you can give your answer through that interface. I'll just put it in the chat window also. So you go to menti.com and put in this code 9542061. And we'll just get a quick idea of, you know, what do people think. Okay, let me also share the screen while you, so that you can also see how the answers are evolving. So we are seeing answers like logic, logical thinking, system, computer science, problem solving, coding, programming. Okay. Problem solving, 21st century skills, reasoning. Okay. Sequential learning. Algorithm, critical thinking. Okay. Maths, artificial intelligence, stepwise problem solving, decomposition. Okay. Learning of thinking skills, abstraction, technology, think like computer, okay. Quantification. Okay, there are some interesting answers also are cropping up. Okay, we have about 150 responses, and it's very heartening to note that the main responses which are standing out so far are problem solving, critical thinking, logical thinking, okay, and reasoning, okay, rather than programming. You know, I was a little afraid that programming would turn out to be kind of the winner, and then we would have to, you know, go all the way from saying that it's not just about programming. Anyway, so it's great to see these responses. Let me come back to the presentation. So this actually makes my job a little easier in terms of this talk, because most of you seem to already have a background of what I'm going to talk about. Okay, so if we look at the, you know, what, why, and how of computational thinking, there are some aspects of it. Let me just go into it one by one after this definition. Okay, so computational thinking refers to the thought processes involved in formulating problems and their solutions, so that the solutions are represented in a form that can be effectively carried out by an information processing agent. So this is the classical definition, most often cited, and we'll be hearing Professor Janet Wing herself later on today. So one reference that I can provide is this book called Computational Thinking Education, which is edited by Professor Su Chong Kong of Hong Kong University and Professor Harold Abelson of MIT. And there's a chapter in it on, you know, computational thinking in India, which is been written by me on the Computomasti work. So most of this talk is based on that chapter. And the definition that we will be using for this talk is what is called the operational definition of computational thinking given by IST and CSTA. It basically is a little broader than programming, and it includes formulating problems in a way that enables us to use a computer to help to solve them, automating solutions through algorithmic thinking, which is basically a series of ordered steps, and generalizing and transferring this problem solving process to a wide variety of problems. Okay, so now if we ask the question, why bother about teaching learning of CT? I'm sure a lot of you have already don't need to be told about this. I mean, we are all agreed on this, but nevertheless, you know, if we are talking to colleagues who are not so familiar with it, here are some points. Okay, so one point is that we need to nurture the next generation to become creative problem solvers. And CT helps learners to formulate and solve problems in the digital world. So there is a need for integration of CT in K-12 education, which there are lots of references, and you know, it's very heartening to see the amount of work that is being done by CS Pathshala on this. Okay, In the worst case, if none of these arguments work, there is also the fear of missing out, right? The FOMO effect. So many countries have already started implementing CTE in schools in a big way. And so at the very least, we should not be left behind. So that's the, you know, the most common denominator answer. Okay, so I'll give you a few examples. So this is from the set of books that Venki had mentioned called Computer Masti. So my own exercise in this direction started in 2007. So when my son was in the first standard and I looked at the computer books at that time and I decided that I didn't want him learning computers from those books, which basically had screenshots of Microsoft Word and, you know, questions of the sort, how many colors are there in the palette and so on. So it was a longish effort and it took us a while to, you know, write the curriculum. And then we also wrote the teacher handbooks. And then we realized that it's not enough to only write the teacher handbooks and went on to write the textbooks. So after writing the textbooks, we discovered that it's not enough to just write the textbooks. It's necessary to do the teacher training. So at some point, you know, I started a company in 2009 for taking this out to schools. And then in 2016, this was acquired by another company called Next Education. And today this Computer Masti is a product of Next Education. However, these books are all released in Creative Commons and they can be freely downloaded from my website. So if you Google Computer Masti, it will just directly take you to the website from where you can download these books and use them freely. So this would make a good complement to the content that you get from CS Pathshala. Okay, so basically it addresses aspects of problem solving such as algorithmic thinking, logical reasoning. It addresses aspects of logical data handling. No, that was not such a common term that came up in the word cloud. And also talks about multiple data representation. So these two are not so commonly thought of as part of computational thinking, but actually they are. Okay, so here's an example. So it's a very common example and which all of you will be familiar with, which is basically stepwise thinking. And the way it works in Computer Masti is that there is this character called Moz, who is a facilitator. So this Moz is a facilitator. And there are two children, Jyoti and Tejas, who are actually trying to learn it. And basically through that, they learn that, you know, any activity has a sequence of steps. And it's useful if we follow a problem decomposition approach of first listing the main steps and then for each main step, we list the detailed steps. So it will be surprising to see for how long through one's career this simple idea actually holds. So I do a very similar activity even in my MTech class. And the number of people who dive into details before they have thought through the main steps is phenomenal. Okay, so it cannot be underemphasized that stepwise thinking, the ideas of problem decomposition, the ideas that we build in as function calls or subroutines and so on, are very important ideas that are broadly applicable everywhere. Okay, so to give you a quick feel of how the content evolves, it starts up in grade 3 of breaking up a non-computer activity. Okay, let me see if I can use the pointer. Okay, so it starts in grade 3 where we say, okay, we are breaking up a non-computer based activity into steps. And then it kind of extends in grade 4 where we are talking about, there are some constraints now which are beginning to apply. In grade 5, they have to kind of identify known and unknown information and go and gather information. In grade 6, they learn how to do pros and cons analysis, how to choose between multiple solutions, how to apply, reasoning, decision-making, and so on. And in 7 onwards, they solve increasingly complex problems. So this is basically the way the curriculum has been structured. And I won't go into more details about that here. Okay, here's another example of applying stepwise thinking and programming. So we use Scratch in the book as the programming language from grades 3 to 6. And then we use Basic after that. So here's a very elementary example that Shilpa has to go from here to there. So there's a notion of integrating with something that the children are already familiar with. So they're already familiar with it. And so there is a corresponding scratch program which they write, which takes, which gets the idea of what is the connection between everyday activities and a computational activity, which can be done using a programming language. Okay, so having said that, it's time for another break. So all these orange or whatever color slide that you're seeing are slides when I take a break and you do some work. Okay, so this activity is basically for you to express your opinion. So you can do this using the chat window itself. We don't want to go anywhere else. And you can actually turn your chat to saying all attendees. And the question is basically, is it just another buzzword for programming? Because the CS guys are like that, right? I mean, we always like to kind of push the ideas and pretend as though these ideas didn't exist earlier. So is it just another buzzword for programming? So do you agree, yes or no, is the first thing. And why I have not set it up as a poll is that, you know, I would like you to also write your reason in the chat window. So I'm going to come out of this full screen mode and go off to the chat window. Okay. Okay, there are a whole bunch of no's, but we can do CT without knowing any programming language. I'm just reading quickly. I'll read out a few answers that come. Predominantly, the answers are no. CT is a way of life, somebody's saying. We do it every day. It's a skill which teaches us to think critically. Step-by-step approach can be easy to write programs. CT was always there. If math is taught well, many of these objectives will be achieved. Yes. Okay, now it's moving too fast for me to read, but I'll still try to read a few. Okay, programming has additional implementation aspects. It's a subset. Programming is a subset of CT, yes. Okay, it's not another buzzword because it involves building algorithms. Okay. It involves step-by-step inculcation into developing thinking skills. Okay. It's not dependent on implementation details. Okay, I think most of you are kind of leaning in the same direction of saying that it's not entirely a new buzzword. There are very few yeses for yes, it's a buzzword. Okay, it's not completely depending on programs or computers. Okay, so let me go back to the presentation. Thank you for your responses. So a lot of people have responded. Thanks for that. And let me go back to the presentation and see. Okay, so here are some typical audience responses. So this is a talk that I had given last year at T4E. And so some people kind of think that CT is the same as programming because everyone talks about it in the context of programming or because it is step-by-step and so on. But like most of you have said, it is not the same as programming because these ideas have been explored in other domains as well. And it's mostly about thinking, you know, not about programming. And like many of you have also observed, programming is a subset, or see, one aspect of CT is programming. Okay. So thank you for your responses. And let me just summarize by saying that learning of computational thinking is not the same as learning of programming. Although learning to program can help in the learning of CT. Okay, so CT is a superset of skills of which programming is one skill. And some of the other skills are logically organizing and analyzing data, representing data through abstractions such as models and simulations, identifying, analyzing, and implementing solutions, right? Doing some pros and cons analysis, you know, doing some optimization. So these are all other skills which are part of what we call as the CT framework. So here is one view of the CT framework. So there are multiple frameworks available. And since I thought, you know, let me also introduce some research aspects. So this is one popularly used framework for categorizing different aspects of computational thinking. Okay, so it categorizes into concepts, practices, and perspectives. Okay, so in concepts, what we see is basically these are your typical programming constructs. Okay, so computational concepts that learners develop in programming. So often people stop here, and that's why they conflate CT with programming. But then we see that there are also CT practices, where we have things like problem formulation, and then while there is also algorithmic thinking, while there is also iteration and testing and debugging, which are all found in programming, these are all often done in non-programming settings also. And then finally, we have the notion of CT perspectives, so where they are able to express their ideas using computational concepts. Okay, so that is basically programming empowerment and perspectives of expressing. So this is one framework. So those of you who want to go deeper into research in CT, this is a good place to start by looking at this framework and getting a hang of what exactly falls in CT and what does not. Okay, so here's another quick question: is CT only for computer science topics? Okay, so in some audiences, I take a couple of minutes to discuss this question. But for this audience, we don't need that, because most of you have already answered that it's not. And that's correct, that CT is not just for CS topics or for CS students. It is much broader, and it can be found in several disciplines. Like this reference that I have quoted here has a list of 20 disciplines in which there are research papers on CT. Okay, so here are some more examples again from Computer Masti for CT in a non-programming setting. So the first example is about setting up a home aquarium, where you divide, this is in grade 5, where you divide what you know, what you don't know, and then you go on to, gather information, identify constraints, what is the budget, what is the type of the fish that can be kept, and so on. And then use logical thinking to identify choices. So over the years, this project has been implemented in a lot of schools, and a lot of children have said that after going through this such a curriculum, they find that they are able to use these ideas in projects in their other subjects also. Okay, so then there is also the idea of applying CT when we create presentations, right? So often, many people have the idea that if I have to create a presentation, I have to use a lot of fonts, and I have to use a lot of colors, and I have to use some lot of animation. Actually, that's not true. So the idea is about communicating your own ideas. And again, it's best done if we approach it systematically. So the same idea of deciding what is it that we want to talk about, and then writing some details about each point. So that's again a basic computational thinking being applied to creating presentations. So like the slide says, it's about three stages, where you plan, and then you execute, and then finally you add some visual effects in order to make it sticky for the audience. Okay, so then let me give a few more examples. CT applied in STEM. STEM stands for Science, Technology, Engineering, Mathematics. And nowadays it's been expanded to STEAM, where A stands for Arts. So this is a work by Professor Gautam Biswas at Vanderbilt University. This is called C2STEM. So the idea here is the learning of the domain, right? Physics or something, by attempting to model. So students learn by building computational models of the science process and then applying the models to problem-solving tasks. So it's a very interesting approach of going back and forth between the science domain and the computational domain, thereby strengthening both the domains. Okay, and then there is also CT, which we can find in literature. Okay, so here is somebody who was Frank Moretti of Stanford, who has applied CT to Hamlet. And the basic idea here was to actually just represent everything as a graph, all the people as a graph, and there's a link between two people if there has been a link. So analyzing these network diagrams where the characters are nodes and two characters are joined if they've interacted, Okay, so it turns out that there are only two people who manage to survive this region of death, and somehow they are able to kind of say that, you know, this indicates who was the culprit and so on. Okay. Then there is computational thinking applied in e-textiles, where there is notion of learning by making. This is by Professor Yasmin Kafai of Penn State University. So students devise their own projects. They sew with a conductive thread and write computer programs for microprocessors. Okay, so this, the approach is again here to explore computer science by doing non-CS type of activities. So we also have a slightly different project at IIT Bombay, which is in the realm of tinkering. So tinkering, as some of you may know, it's basically, it's the basis for the skill of making, or the skill of identifying what we can do and how to do with things and so on. So those of you who have these Atal tinkering labs in your schools, you know, may be able to identify with this a little better. So what this is, one of our students, Ashutosh Raina, what he has done is he's come up with a tinkering kit and a corresponding pedagogy of letting students explore. Of letting students exploring the resource affordances, so that students can see what they can do and what they can do with it, and then using it to solve a simple problem which is given, and then eventually evolving it to solve bigger problems. So this pedagogy is called Explore, Solve, Evolve. And through that, students are able to solve. So we have used it with school students as well as for college students with appropriately different set of problems in order to nurture the skill of tinkering. So this is another example that we can take a look at. Okay. So again, to just give you a quick break. So there is a lot of CT work. I mean, the CT is not at all new. So there's a lot of work in India. And the most ancient one is apparently from Chandas Shastra. So Professor K. Ramasubramaniam from our department of HSS is actually a scholar and expert in all this. And basically, when I asked him, saying, okay, can you give me an example of CT? This is the sutra that he gave me. It goes as Dvirdyunam Tadantanam, and let me see if I can play his audio. Okay, so this is a 2-minute audio, so I'll just play maybe a minute of it.
Laghu, like in the word Rama, and both can be Guru, like we have Krishnam. An interesting question has been posed by Pingalacharya in his Chandas Shastra. Given n syllables, he asked this question.
Check whether it's happening. You can't hear it. People are saying no. Okay, so let me get out of the...
We could hear it.
Okay, there were a bunch of people who said no, so I was a little...
Very clearly.
All right, okay, let me go on. Okay, let me just back it a bit. Yeah, we'll play it for a minute.
An interesting question has been posed by Pingalacharya in his Chandas Shastra. Given n syllables, he asked this question, how many possible patterns that can be generated up to n syllables? So this is basically a mathematical problem wherein we need to find sum of sums. The solution to this has been presented in the 8th chapter of his text Chandas Shastra, which goes as Dvirdvyunam Tadantanam. Tadantanam refers to the number of patterns that can be generated with n syllables. That has to be multiplied by 2, dvihi, and then he says dvyunam, which means 2 has to be subtracted from them. So this in mathematical parlance amounts to 2 to the n plus 1 minus 2. As we can see, so this is basically the sum of a geometric series having n terms, with the first term being 2 and the common ratio being 2.
Okay, so that was Professor K. Ramasubramaniam from our Department of HSS establishing that CT has been there in ancient India. And in more recent times, what we have are the work that I have been talking about. Maybe I'll stop sharing and start again. Okay. I'm not going to go into this. Okay, some reason this has frozen. Okay, this is the usual PowerPoint related issue has happened. It has frozen for some reason. Okay, let me come back to it again and hopefully get out of it in some way. All right, okay. All right. So the CT work in India is basically, as you know, I just talked about Computer Masti, and then Venki also mentioned this T-LOTS project, which is what we are trying to do at the higher education level. I'll just give you a couple of examples in a moment. And then there is, of course, CS Pathshala. And then if you look at Amrita University, they're also doing some work in this area, which is about developing tinkering mindset in school children. So I'm sure there is other work which I am not aware of. So in case you are among those who are doing some work in this area and I miss listing you, do send me an email so that I can include it in the next iteration. Okay. So again, now if we pause to reflect, you know, is CT just another buzzword for problem solving? So basically what we are doing is we are looking at the two extremes. At one extreme, we ask the question, is CT just another buzzword for programming? And now, and we decided that no, it's more than programming. So now we are saying, that is it, we are looking at the other extreme to see, is it just another buzzword for problem solving, which has been around for millennia? So it turns out here that there's no clear answer yet. So the debate is still ongoing. So different proponents of CT have different pet positions on this. For example, Mark Gasdyl subscribes to this minimalistic definition, which basically says that, you know, what is it that we have to learn in order to communicate our tasks with the computer? So the minimal part is what is CT, everything else is problem solving. Okay, and then there is Weintraub, who talks about the empirical definition, which basically talks about the computational practices of actual scientists and engineers who use computing. So what are these computational practices? Like, one of them could be iteration. Like, you do an experiment and then you change one value and then you do the same experiment again and then you plot a graph and or you do something, you do a problem decomposition, you split a problem into sub problems. So these are computational practices which actual scientists and engineers use. So the empirical definition includes these practices, and then there is also the debate or the discussion on the implications of defining CT in a restricted manner versus a wider, more open definition. Okay, so it's not like everybody has agreed upon what is CT. Okay, so here's my personal take on this. So the debate on is CT equal to problem solving has not yet converged, and I'm inclined to take this stance. Okay, so CT is not just programming. So it is a bunch of programming concepts. So from the framework that we saw, Brennan-Resnick framework that we saw earlier, we take some CT concepts and some CT practices. That's what we are calling as programming practices. And then we also take some disciplinary practices. Okay, so add some practices of actual scientists and engineers. I'll come to an example in a moment. So these together comprise what we call as computer, what we could call as computational thinking, which is now broadly applicable to a large number of engineering fields. Okay, so let me give you an example. So this is an example of CT in higher education, or also an example of what we mean by disciplinary practice. So let's say troubleshooting. So if you want to do troubleshooting, whether you're troubleshooting your home network, or whether you're troubleshooting why a light bulb is not glowing, or whether you're troubleshooting a car, so irrespective of what you're trying to troubleshoot, the stages that you go through are pretty much very similar. Okay, it's a process which ranges from identification of the problem and implementing the action to fix them. So it involves understanding the problem, it involves generating a hypothesis, and then coming up with a priority of which hypothesis to test, designing these tests, and then interpreting the results, and then, you know, iterating on that process. So the claim here is, so this is work being done by one of my PhD students, Kavya. And the claim here is that working through these troubleshooting stages systematically is an application of CT. And so getting students to do these troubleshooting activities with explicit reflection can lead to the inculcation of CT. Similarly, I'll give you one more example and I'll stop. So this example is of divergent and convergent thinking in design. So here again, what we need to see is software design is a process which is ranging from requirements analysis to, you know, detailed design to testing. And if we look at conceptual design, most of us will agree that, you know, it involves first expanding the problem space by considering multiple perspectives, and then you are reducing the problem into sub-problems. Then you generate multiple alternative solutions, and then choose what is a good fit or a best fit type of a solution for the given constraints. So here again, the point is, when we make students go through this process of design, irrespective of whether it is programming or whether it is, you know, designing some product, they learn CT. So again, working through these stages systematically is an application of CT. Okay, so teaching learning of design includes teaching learning of some CT practices. Okay, so this is nearly my last slide. So since I had said that I will also talk about some research opportunities in computational thinking, so it's actually fairly broad and open right now. And one easy way of getting into it is to design and evaluate interventions to develop CT in your students. Okay, so basically it involves creating some intervention, which is learning activities that involve use of CT in various domains, and then show explicit mapping between your design and the learner's development. So because I did this, they developed that CT. So you have to fix the definitions and then show the mapping between that, and then do evaluation to explicitly show. By evaluation, it means we have to carry out some tests and some interviews and so on to show that CT has been developed. So it would be great if you can, if you take this up and submit a paper, not just to CTIS, but also, you know, there are these other conferences which we run in India. One is called T4E, which is Technology for Education. This is an IEEE conference. And the other one is Compute, which you may be familiar with already, which is ACM's conference on computing. And for help with planning studies, etc., again, if you go to our departmental webpage, there are a lot of resources that we have put up there. Okay, so with that, let me come to the close. So what's the takeaway? The key point I would like to make here is that CT is not automatically acquired while learning content. Okay, it's not like, okay, I simply learn and automatically I have learned this. I mean, we have seen it time and again. M.Tech students are not able to apply it when they come to a M.Tech class on, let's say, whatever topic, it doesn't matter. So learning of CT needs explicit training, and the sooner we start, the better. The second point is, one way to train for computational thinking is through programming concepts and practices. But transferring that to a non-programming context does not happen automatically. So nothing happens automatically. No, CT is not learned automatically, nor is it transferred automatically. Both of these need explicit attention and explicit training. So if you want students to be able to apply CT in a non-computational scenario, what we have to do is we have to train them. We have to give them multiple such examples, like planning a picnic or like, you know, doing a project, you know, setting up an aquarium, etc., etc. Bring out what is the CT that is involved in doing that, and show them explicitly how the same steps are occurring again and again in different projects. And that's when it becomes internalized. So that's the basic point. And I'm sure as teachers, you've already also seen this in your own classes. Okay, there are a lot of things that I've not talked about. Here are a bunch of references to the points that I made. And there are a lot of things that I've not talked about, which are tools, assessment, non-formal learning, etc. And this presentation itself is available from my website. So if you just Google Sridhar Iyer IIT Bombay, you can go download this presentation. You are also free to use material from this presentation in your own talks. With that, thank you very much. And back to you, Venkatesh. It's 3 o'clock.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, Sridhar. It was a very interesting talk. And I'm sure everyone enjoyed it. And there are a few questions for you.
Okay. Will you be reading them out?
Yeah, I'm reading them out.
Okay.
So the first one is, yes, the teachers do believe that computational thinking should be taught and it's not just programming. But when they try to teach in a class, let's say flowchart design, algorithm design, and or anything, students want to directly dive into scratch programming, and even parents prefer to get that done. So how would you address this problem?
So this is a very important point, because even when we wrote Computer Masti, you know, so we had an explicit chapter called Stepwise Thinking, which came before the Scratch chapter, and which had nothing to do with computers. So it was all about, you know, move around in the here, go from here to there, and so on. And in the initial few years, the feedback that I got from schools is, you know, why is this chapter here? Remove this chapter from the book. You know, it makes no sense to have a chapter which has no programming in it. So it is a matter of, you know, education. And while students get to it by, you know, let them do the scratch programming, and as long as we keep showing them the similarity, see, what has to be stressed is what is the same thing. You know, this is nothing but what you have done before. As long as we keep showing them that, you know, oh, you wrote a scratch program for making the sprite move in a maze. See, when you do this, when you're taking your car and you're navigating, Google Maps is doing the same thing. So when we show some things like that, that's when they realize that there is an abstract nature to it, and they are able to acquire it. For parents and teachers, you know, we have to keep on telling them that, look, it is broadly applicable.
Thanks, Sridhar. Another question is, how can CT be taught while teaching economics to school students, or commerce or accountancy to school students?
Oh, definitely. See, today though, there is a lot of emphasis on data and data analytics and all of that. So that is definitely one component. So you can start with simple graphing, where it doesn't matter. See, you can expand the definition of CT a little bit to just say systematic thinking also. And so you could start with, let's say, I don't know the domain very well. So I'm trying to come up with an example on the fly. So you could start with some scenario in which, you know, they have to do some, you know, inventory analysis and maybe some planning of, you know, how much stock to maintain depending upon supply and demand. And there you can actually bring out, okay, so look, this is what is happening behind the scenes. You know, when a shopkeeper is doing that, the shopkeeper was doing it intuitively. And today there are a lot of algorithms which are actually helping the Amazons and the Walmarts to figure these inventory out. So there are ways in which we can inculcate it. And even if we don't have to struggle to find them, you know, we can take the simplest one. As long as your students are thinking more and more systematically, I think you're doing a good job. It doesn't matter whether we call it CT or mathematics or whatever else.
Yeah, thanks. What are your thoughts on training, mentoring, or grooming our school children on these concepts, keeping in mind the time available to them?
Yeah, so the time is a big issue, you know. So, see, many of these things get relegated to after-school activities. So when we had actually come up with Computer Masti, CSIT was not a core subject at all. So it had to be clubbed with, you know, the other after-school activities or the extracurricular activities. So at the very least, let it be that, you know, instead of eliminating it altogether. And I think slowly it will come into mainstream. More and more people are realizing its need. So what is a good way of doing that is this idea called thematic integration. So if you look at the, you know, Computer Masti web page that I talked about, so the curriculum document actually says that how can we do this thematic integration? What do we mean by thematic integration? Is basically when I am talking about geography, how do I also use that to teach some other CT concepts? So if we can write some content, supplementary content to the geography textbook, which actually says that, okay, or maybe, you know, use an AR marker nowadays, just put a sticker in the textbook where we can say that, look, okay, if you are more interested in the CT aspect of this this concept, you can just, you know, hold your phone over it and go look at it. So those are ways in which we'll have to bring it in, and then eventually it will become mainstream.
Yeah, correct. So there is, of course, a request for links from where they can download your books, your various content. And
So all of this is basically, you just have to Google Sridhar Iyer IIT Bombay. Let me see if I can just quickly show you those web pages that I'm talking. Okay. Let me just share my browser. Okay, so this was a Mentimeter link. This will also be useful to kind of keep. So you just say, okay. So if you Google Sridhar Iyer IIT Bombay, it will take you to this page. This is my basic web page. And if you click on Computer Masti here, it will take you to the first link up here that you see is the curriculum document. It's basically a 60-page document which defines, you know, what should be taught, how it should be taught, and so on. And then these are the links for downloading those individual books. And similarly, if you Google Educational Technology IIT Bombay, it will take you to this page, which is our departmental webpage. And here, if you look at resources, again, you will find several handbooks that we have created for how to do research in educational technology. And you can use these resources in your own research. Okay.
Yeah. Another interesting question. How different is computational thinking from analytical skills?
How different is computational thinking? So again, see, these are all, there is a lot of overlap between these areas. Okay. So, and each generation comes up with different terminology. Okay. And it's sort of, sometimes it can be considered as old wine in new bottles. Okay. Now it depends upon what exactly you mean by analytical thinking. You know, where do you draw the boundary? So any definition can be expanded to include more and more things and thereby encompass, you know, all of problem solving. So that's why I asked that question very specifically. You know, is it all the way up to problem solving? Where does CT stop and where does some other type of problem solving begin? So that is a question that each of us have to answer for ourselves. And what is important is to be very precise about the definitions that we are using in order to come to that call. So if you're using definition A for CT and definition B for analytical thinking, you may come to the conclusion that CT and analytical thinking are very different. On the other hand, if you're using a definition X for CT and, you know, some other definition Y for analytical thinking, you may come to the conclusion that they are the same thing.
Yeah. Okay. So if CT is to be part and parcel of teaching, mainly for secondary and higher secondary grades, what would your approach be to train teachers to ingrain CT in their teaching?
Yeah.
So I assume they are referring to other subjects as well.
Yeah. So this is a problem that we have been working on for a while, actually. So, and it's not an easy problem, you know, not because of, you know, teacher competence. So often people, you know, the first thing that people jump on is saying, oh, teachers don't know. Actually, that's not the problem. The problem is, there is no room in the timetable. So it's the packedness of the timetable, which is, so if we go towards a more integrated curriculum, you know, where two teachers are somehow collaborating, it's not, I mean, it happens in some schools which can control their own syllabus and their own timetable. Okay, but for other teachers, what I would say is that, you know, it's not like all of us know some CT or the other. It doesn't matter whether you heard the term CT or whether you have not heard the term CT. When you go to, let's say, whatever, some website to book your ticket, etc., you're actually applying CT in some way. So as long as teachers are aware that, look, this is going to be an important skill for our students going forward, and let me try to inculcate this in my subject to the best way I can, then, you know, I think teachers can themselves do it. It's not like the teachers don't know CT and they have to be taught CT first and so on. Everybody knows it. It's a matter of making it more explicit and making it both for the teachers as well as for the students. Okay.
Yes. I think we have time for a couple more questions.
Sure.
So there is this question which many teachers will be facing. If they're starting in standard 5 and the children haven't learned any computational thinking earlier, and so therefore they don't have a basic founding, how would you advise them to go about teaching CT?
Okay. So one of the things that we have to do, okay. So firstly, when we started writing Computer Masti, I asked this question, when should it be introduced? Okay. And then decided that, you know, even by looking at psychology, etc., is that around the age of 8 is actually the best, is a good time to introduce these topics such as systematic thinking and so on, because that's when the child's, you know, that part of the brain starts developing, etc. So there is no point in introducing these ideas all the way in first standard. So what we settled for was to introduce them in third standard. And then it turns out that a lot of schools and governments have said that let's introduce it only from fifth standard upwards. So what happens? So one of the things that we can do is, you know, you can think about having for the first year of introduction, you can have some kind of a bridging. So if you take a fifth standard child, for example, that child would have also gone to a mall and, you know, done some activities. So there are a lot of real life experiences which any child up to fifth standard would have reached, which can be used to bring out the CT aspect of those experiences. So that's where we'll have to start. So we'll have to write some bridge curriculum, which will actually bridge what you hope that they would have already encountered to where the curriculum is starting in fifth standard.
Yeah.
Taking a third standard curriculum and deploying it in fifth standard is a waste of time. And I think that's right. What the question actually
is. Yeah. Right. You're right. Yeah. So thanks, Sridhar, once again for a very entertaining talk and a lot of answers. There are still many more questions. Unfortunately, we have run out of time. To all those who have asked those questions, we will try and capture those questions and get back to you with answers. Thank you all those who asked questions. Thank you very much.